All right, let's go to Genesis 18. All right. The Lord appeared to Abraham near the great trees of Mamre while he was sitting at the entrance to his tent in the heat of the day. Abraham looked up and saw three men standing nearby. And when he saw them, he hurried from the entrance of his tent to meet them and bowed low to the ground. He said, "If I have found favor in your eyes, my Lord, do not pass your servant by. Let little water be brought, and then I will wash your feet and the rest of the tree. Let me get you something to eat so that you can be refreshed and go on your way now that you have come to your servant." We're going to go down to 9. "Where is your wife Sarah?" they asked him. "There in the tent," he said. Then one of them said, "I will surely return to you about this time next year, and Sarah, your wife, will have a son." Now Sarah was listening at the entrance of the tent, which was behind him, and Abraham and Sarah were already very old. Sarah was past the age of childbearing, so Sarah laughed at herself to herself as she thought, "After I'm worn out, my Lord, and my Lord is old, now I'll have this pleasure." Anybody been there? Yeah. No? Okay. Then the Lord said to Abraham, "Why does Sarah laugh and say, 'Will I really have this child now that I'm old?' Is anything too hard for the Lord? I will return to you at an appointed time next year, and Sarah will have a son." Sarah was afraid, so she lied and said, "I didn't laugh." And he said, "Yeah, you did." I've had things the Lord has told me before, and I'm like, really? Yeah, I think we've all been there in some fashion. Maybe not 100 years old of having a baby, but, you know, something in our life where we've kind of been like, okay. All right, Genesis 21, 1 through 5. "Now the Lord was gracious to Sarah as he had said, and the Lord did for Sarah what he had promised. Sarah became pregnant and bore a son to Abraham in his old age. At the very time God had promised him, Abraham gave the name Isaac to the son Sarah bore him. When his son Isaac was 8 days old, Abraham circumcised him as God had commanded. Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born to him. Sarah said, "God has brought me laughter, and everyone who hears about this will laugh with me." And she said, "Who would have said to Abraham that Sarah would nurse children? Yet I have borne him a son in his old age." Now we're going to move on to 22. We're going through this just to do a timeline, and we'll get to the point in a minute. "Sometime later, God tested Abraham, and he said to him, 'Abraham, here I am,' he replied. Then God said, 'Take your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on a mountain I will show you.'" Now we're going to show a clip, and I apologize for those of you online. We do have a link to the clip, and you're welcome to go to it. It's 40 seconds in. So we're going to show this clip, and they'll be right back with you.
"Father, we have the firewood, but where's the lamb?"
"The Lord will provide a sacrifice, my son."
"Did Abraham take a lamb?"
"No, mistress."
"Bring the wood."
What are you doing? trusting you, Father.
Isaac, you must trust in God.
It's a really powerful scene of what God asked Abraham to do based on obedience. Are you willing to go the extra mile of what God asks you to do? Are we willing to sacrifice and lay down our Isaac, the promised will of God, the promise that God gave to them, that they even messed up? Abraham and Sarah took it into their own hands even before she had gotten pregnant. And then got another lady pregnant. And it just, even though they messed up the promise, God still gave them the promise, but they had to be willing to lay it down. He couldn't go to the mountain of Moriah and say, oh, I'll do this, and then hopefully God will provide, hopefully God will save. That you could do that, but he didn't stop the action of doing the sacrifice, of causing the sacrifice to happen. He did it knowing that God may or may not stop him. I remember the first time that God asked me to lay down my Isaac. It was, again, this is a little bit on the trivial side now that I've lived the life I've lived. It's powerful, but it's, anyway, okay, I'm just going to tell you a story. So at 25, I wasn't married yet, and I was desperate for a spouse and a family. As a 25-year-old, had already been a pastor and had been here at leading this ministry for 5 years, leading parts of this ministry for 5 years. And I had lived a lot of life, and I was really, really lonely, and I had fallen in love with love. It was everything to me, and probably easy to say that it was my God. Everything about falling in love and all of that was something that I was extremely passionate about and also believed that God owed it to me. That he owed it to me and his promises to give me what I had asked for, what I had wanted, and what he had promised me. So because of my worshiping at the altar of love and then not having it, I would have these moments of time where I would just break down. I would have 6 to 9 months. Every 6 to 9 months, I would fall apart. I had lots of drama and stuff going on in my real day-to-day life, but it was exasperated by the fact that everywhere I looked, there wasn't anyone that I could have. I hadn't dated anyone, hadn't gone on a date, hadn't had a boyfriend, hadn't had anything, and I felt that it was owed to me because of my faithfulness, it was owed to me to have that. So because of my putting that on a pedestal and worshiping at the God of love, I was wounded every time it didn't happen, and then I was mad at God. So I would often hear these stories about people that would lay down, you know, their dream, and then they turn around and there it is. And so I would pray these prayers over and over, and I would sacrifice, you know, okay, Jesus, I would surrender. Okay, Lord, I surrender. You know, you don't owe me anything. You know, like I would say the prayer and then 5 seconds later be looking, okay, where is it now? And that's just the wrong attitude to have. When we are surrendering, we can't go at the idea that we're going to be rescued in our surrender. It has to be a surrendering because God is who he is. God says who he is, and he doesn't owe us anything that he hasn't already given us. So this pivotal moment in February of 2005, I had just returned from a 6-week trip to Toronto, and I had come back, and I was pretty different. There was something different about me, and I obviously had gotten to a point where I had surrendered a bunch of things, but this still was in the balance. I remember I was going into a staff meeting. I was in my mom's office, and I just felt the Lord say, "Are you ready?" And I was like, I know exactly what that "are you ready" meant. And I said, "Okay, Lord, I'm ready." So I walked across to the other building into my office, and I sat in the corner in a little recliner I had. And I sat there, and it was almost like the roof opened. The heavens just, you know those movies, the shine just shines right down on the person that, you know, that's kind of what I felt like. And the Lord was like, "Are you ready?" And I said, "Jesus, I'm ready. I'm ready to surrender this. I'm so tired of being on this hamster wheel of going around and around and around." You know the definition of insanity. I was there trying to get a different result every time I went around this hamster wheel. And I just remember I raised my hands and I said, "Jesus, I don't care what is in my future. If it's a husband, if it's children, I don't want that holding me back anymore from the promises that you've called me to, from the goodness in my life, from you being all powerful in my life." And I, at that moment, surrendered. I fell on my knees. The heavens opened. I want to say I was there for an hour or two. It could have been 10 minutes. I don't really know. Time stopped. And I just poured my heart out. And I had this grief moment where I was grieving the actions that I had allowed myself to believe, think, and walk in, that I had somehow believed that God owed it to me because of my faithfulness and my walk prior to that, because I had been pure, because I had made the right decisions, because I said no to guys that wanted to be, you know, with me or whatever. And I was like, I let go of all of that. It's not mine. It's yours. I surrendered at that moment. And I said, "Jesus, I will never bring this up again. I will never ask you for a husband. I won't look at men that way anymore. And I won't ask you for children. This is dead." And I did that laying down of my Isaac, what I had been thought that I had been promised, what I thought was owed to me, what I thought God wanted for my life. I had even been so bold to say previously in conversations when I had heard people do this, "God better not ask me to do that." And I meant it. I was not. I thought that saying these things were like in stone or something. I don't know. I was dumb. But I know some of us can relate. And I was just like, "God better not ask me. I have laid my life down for him. I have done everything right. I. Oh, my Lord. All the blessings I was stealing from him, all the things that I was stealing by saying I all the time. So I surrendered my life to him. People were starting to get together, boyfriend, girlfriends, friends of mine, and I just would sit there with tears in my eyes, just, "I'm not going to ever have that. But Jesus, I want you. But Jesus, I want you. I want you to be powerful." And I would just go through this process of mourning that in my life. Now, obviously, I'm married with children, and God brought it full circle, but I didn't make it happen. I wasn't looking for it. It just kind of came, and then When I need to say this. When I committed that and kind of killed it, I had said, "Jesus, I will never touch it again. But if you want to do something with it, it's in your hands." So it wasn't that I just completely, I said, "Lord, I won't bring it up anymore." And, you know, it was truly a turning point in my life. And I believe truly that it was what set me up to be able to walk out the life I've lived since then. And I'll go into that in a second, but I had to be willing to take a step off the cliff regardless of the outcome. I had to be willing to jump. And now we're going to show, I'm sorry, online, we're going to show another video clip, but the link is in the comments. Please link it. It's a clip from Indiana Jones.
The healing power of the Grail is the only thing that can save your father now. It's time to ask yourself what you believe.
Thank you. from the lion's head, will you prove his worth?
You. So, I mean, even when he's stepping off that cliff, I always like, you know, every time we know he's going to get caught, it's still like, and I think the same thing is when God's asking us to do something, we feel we're going to fall and he's not going to catch us. We feel if we give up our dreams, we sacrifice or surrender the things that are most important in our life, that he's not going to give us something better or make that happen. So often we're so bound by the serving the promises. I'm sorry, let me read it. Do you want the promises more than the God of the promises? Let me say that again. Are you more fixated on the promises that you feel are owed to you or that he's spoken to you than the God who gave the promise to begin with? God doesn't change his mind, but it's not always in the timing we want. And it's about our hearts. It's about where we are with our life and our choices that we make. So that was the first time I had to surrender my future. And then, you know, I get married, have my first pregnancy, there's no baby. Second pregnancy, no baby. We had to then, you know, come again. Well, if we never have children, am I still going to love Jesus? If we never get to hold a baby in our arms, am I still going to serve him? And then our first baby came, and we held her, and we loved her, and second baby, and our third baby. And then at age, in 2016, our four-year-old is diagnosed with leukemia. And we're sitting there at our bedside, and we have to surrender again. We don't know what it's going to withhold. We don't know what the future's going to hold. We don't know what it's going to look like. And we sat there, and it was like, she's not ours. She's yours. You might have promised me kids, but you didn't say I get to keep them. I have a little bit of a dark humor sometimes because of the irony of things that go on. So that's why I laugh, because God's joy is really powerful as well. And then 3 years later, the battle is lost, and we hold her while she takes her last breath in our arms. At 7 years old, what we thought was a promise is now taken from us. What do we do with that? We take the leap of faith and we have to say, no, Jesus, she was never ours. She was yours. You gave her to us as a gift for 7 years. And it all started with this idea and this concept that we have to lay down our Isaacs. If you're holding on to them, have you ever heard the story of the monkey that puts his hand in the jar and he's stuck? He's captured. The only thing in between him and freedom is let go. No, but you said, God, but you said. I did say, but it's time to let go. And let my say be what molds your life instead of you holding on to it with the fist raised high. There was a moment in her treatment. I've told this story before, so I apologize. But there was a moment in her treatment in 2017 when she was coming out of a coma and there was fluid on her brain and she had to get a shunt put in her brain. And I felt like a fool, an absolute fool. And I felt like there was a bridge that I had to cross I was going to fall into, because I felt like I had made this declaration that she won't have a shunt. You guys will see. And it's so trivial now with where we're at today. But at that point, that was the straw that was breaking my back. That was like my, haven't we done this right? How dare you? Blah, blah, blah. And I just let it fill me. So I drove home to Orville and had a weekend by myself in my house because I was about ready to blow. And I was really mad at God, and I was like, how dare you? You know, I've said yes to you every second of the step of the way, and now we're going to do this. And I look like a fool, and I marched those hospital hallways, and I told all of them you weren't going to do this, and then here we are. Don't you care that you look like a fool? I was putting it on him more than me. And I was in my bedroom, and for the moment I started shaking my fist at God, this evil presence came in my room, and the enemy was there, and he said, I can take her pain away. I can release her from this if you just say yes. And when you see your daughter suffering, and you see her laying in a bed, she can't remember who you are. Or she's going through all this treatment with all this stuff around her and in her and poking her and prodding her and all this stuff. You want that pain to go. So for the millisecond of a second, I thought, And then I snapped out of it right as soon as I thought that. And I said, no, nothing is great enough for me to ever give my life to you. Nothing is ever great enough for me to give my soul to you. Nothing. Nothing. And I laid her down on the altar again. And I said, Jesus, I put you first again, that you can do whatever you want. I'm sorry that my pride got in the way, that I was embarrassed because I declared something that didn't happen. Some of us are in that same position. You don't have what you were promised. Something got taken. Someone died. Someone doesn't have children. Someone's future didn't turn out the way that we thought it would. Our finances are in ruin. Our house burnt down. Your own story is your story. But are we holding with our hands and our fists closed, saying, no, it's mine? Or are we worshiping and surrendering with our arms wide open, saying, I am going to surrender my life to you, Jesus? That's the question that he asked for us today. It's a gut-wrenching, soul-searching question of surrender. What are you going to do? What are you holding on to that's holding Jesus at bay? I was tested in that moment. I did give her over to the Lord when she took her last breath. And there's nothing special about me. I'm not here to elevate myself. It was gut-wrenching, and I hope nobody else has to have this test. But for that test, I passed. Because I learned to lay my Isaac down. However long ago, 15 years ago, 16. And it starts with little things, saying yes to Jesus. What is your greatest dream or desire that maybe hasn't happened yet, that you're holding out for and that you've held put God in the line for, that he's only good if, or I'm holding out for this? God still fulfilled his promises with Abraham. He didn't withhold it. He had to step off the cliff, though, and find that he was going to get saved. And it wasn't like, okay, I'm going to hold and then look for my Savior. No, it's I'm stepping out knowing that God's good. And if today's my last day, today's my last day. Thanks for watching the Father's House Orville YouTube channel, but don't stop there. We'd love you to subscribe to our channel so that you never miss a live service or a video. Help us spread the message of Jesus by sharing this video with your friends. You can also support the Father's House financially by clicking the Give button. Thanks again for watching today, and we hope to see you again soon.